everybody. My name is Antti Mäkelä. I work as a part-time scientist and also head of Weather and Climate Research Group at the Climate Service Center, which was head. And I have been my topic, main topic has always been like the severe weather, and especially how like especially thunderstorms can be detected and analyzed with the lightning location systems and the data they these systems provide. And here I have a bit of a scattered presentation from different aspects, which could be interesting to most or most of the people here. So here's the content. So just first a short introduction, lightning location systems and the data. Then what different kinds of applications there are, and what kind of applications could be useful to some of you, which if you have not been dealing with this kind of observation before. Then a bit about the future of thunderstorm observations in general, and a short summary. But first, I would like to make a question. So please raise your hands. How many of you have been using or seeing lightning location data in use? So there are, but still many who have not. Okay. So that's the general aspect of this whole thunderstorm topic. So everybody of us, we know thunderstorms, they occur every year in the summertime, like here in Finland. And it's actually one of the most common and most dangerous weather phenomena on the Earth, because there are a lot of people get killed by lightning strike every year, not in Finland, but in areas where you have during the year plenty of lightning. And we also know that the occurrence of thunderstorms, it is also in a really strong correlation to other severe weather events like intense precipitation, also sometimes large hail, especially in the United States, but also in Europe, even in Finland. Then strong winds, these downbursts, and so on. So in this respect, when we monitor lightning, where lightning is occurring, we can also make estimations about these other phenomena. And nowadays, it is quite, if we consider Europe, lightning is routinely observed in real time, actually, over the whole Europe. Actually, nowadays, even over the whole world. And so it is an excellent tool for monitoring where thunderstorms are occurring, and also making different kinds of climatological studies, pinpointing different, for example, in Finland, which areas are more maybe prone to severe thunderstorms or plenty of lightning than some other regions. And also, especially during the last years, many other insurance companies and other sectors are interested in the lightning location data, not necessarily to receive the data, but to get an expert's view what has lightning caused some damage. So this is the basic idea, and here is the basic idea what is the actual lightning flash. So this is a recording with a high-speed video camera. So the actual duration of this whole animation is about to 0.2 seconds, but we can now see the slow motion really clearly different phases what lightning flash has before hitting the ground and making the actual stroke and then making the thunder sound and the bright light and so on. And something about the lightning location system. So in a nutshell, lightning location is really simple compared to many other instrumentation, remote sensing instrumentation. So in general, basically almost all instruments detecting and measuring lightning, they are similar to radio, like a transmission and receiver. So lightning is the like a radio transmitter, which sends like a program signal at a certain frequency. And then if we build an instrument here, in this case lightning location sensor, which is tuned for that specific frequency, then we can detect the program and also estimate from which direction it came from. And then when we have a multiple network of several sensors from these, based on the triangulation, we can estimate where the lightning strike point to ground has been. But there are many different kinds of techniques for detecting lightning, and I won't go into that, but I will mention that in the coming years, during this decade, one especially useful new instrument will be launched, which is like an optical detection of lightning from satellites, and especially from geostationary satellites. And that means that because geostationary satellites, they look all the time the same, like Earth disk. So that means we have a continuous detection of lightning, like from the whole, in this case, like from Europe and from Africa, which is provided, will be provided by HumanSat satellites. Okay, I already discussed this a bit. So this is just the principle of lightning location. Like I mentioned, we have sensors installed. They have usually baselines, so the distance between the sensors are, let's say, some hundreds of kilometers. And then when we have several sensors and they detect the lightning signal, the electromagnetic signal, they make a really exact timestamp, GPS timestamp to the observation, and then measure from which direction the azimuth where the signal came from. And then based on this information, we can quite accurately estimate its actual strike point. And the sensors, they send this information, the temporal and the azimuth information to the central processing computer, and then which calculates, processes the data, finds the optimum location for each of the strokes, and then, for example, plots on a map. So on the right, you have a map with lots of points, and each point is one located flash. And here the colors represent different UTC hours. So this could be one simple tool for visualization. And then the actual data, I already mentioned it's that the lightning location principle is it's quite simple, and also the data is really simple. So here is one example what the data could look like. So in real time, the sensor processor provides like the information, the information of the located flashes, and one ASCII row represents one located flash. For example, here we have the first row there. There is a time, the date and time information, then a latitude, longitude, so a fixed point on ground, and then also, some systems give information about the actual peak current, so how to say the strength of the whole flash. So, based on also the previous presentations, like Pauli's presentation, you can imagine that this kind of data is really simple to plot on a map, like with Python or GNUplot or with Excel or whatever. So it's really simple and it's fast to produce like real-time products. But also regarding like historical analysis, it's really like a computer processor time, not much consuming to analyze this kind of even big data sets to like calculate climatologies. So here is one example. This is from Nepal. I was there teaching the local people to use lightning location data. And here's one example of what the data could look like from this. I think it's from 1 hour over Nepal of located flashes. So each point is one located flash. And also, based on how much lightning is occurring, like over a certain surface area, we can estimate how intense is the storm, thunderstorm, how much flash it is producing. And then, if we animate this kind of time series, we can see how the thunderstorm has propagated, moved certain areas, and also make now casting to estimate like within the next 2 hours the storm will hit like the Kathmandu airport or whatever. And also regarding different kinds of visualization tools, we can calculate like statistics. Like this is from Finland from 2011. You can see the months, the daily distribution of located flashes over the Finnish territory. So in the y-axis you have the number of located flashes per day, and you have the months and days at the x-axis. So you can see, okay, in the mid-summer we had quite nice, from my perspective, nice time. Then some hour-to-hour analysis. And then about fixing the number of flashes to a certain surface area, that is called the flash density. So how much flash, how much lightning is occurring or has occurred during certain over certain surface area during certain time step. And this time step can be like a year, that is really commonly used, but also daily, per hour, per minute. And these smaller time periods, they are useful, especially in the operational forecasting. So this is 2013, so last year's like the flash density, annual flash density over Finland per 100 square kilometers. So you can see the areas where we had the most of the lightning. And then this goes. This goes also to the Python, so these kind of simple tools can be used to make diagnosis of the how severe is the storm at the different locations. So here we have calculated the flash density, but for a 15-minute period over 100 square kilometer area. And here the color label it's in Finnish, but there is a scale from like a blue to red. And the adjectives say that weak, moderate, like heavy, and violent. So this kind of tools we have developed so that the end user, like for example, operational forecaster, doesn't have to look or analyze any actual values. Because if I say to somebody, okay, the flash density of this area is now 10 units. So the end user might say, okay, is that plenty or not? But if we adjust to these values to certain like scale adjectives, that's really end user friendly. And then lightning can be monitored like globally. And here is like the climatology of lightning from the whole world. And we can see that in the tropics you have most of the lightning in the world. But of course, like we have, for example, in Finland, we have also might have really intense storms here. But the annual accumulation of flashes is quite low compared to the tropical regions, just because we have the thunderstorm season at high latitudes, it's so short. So there is no time to like get plenty of flashes. Then about the future issues. So satellite applications have not been used regarding like the thunderstorm research or at least the lightning location, not much. But during this decade there will be good opportunities to get the data efficiently for large user end user groups and researcher groups, because these different kinds of several different agencies like the EUMETSAT in Europe, and then in USA, the NASA is will be providing this kind of satellite-based geostationary lighting location data. And I think it will be available to everybody. And also, I think the Chinese will be doing similar things. So I think this will be a big jump regarding climate research, regarding the whole our Earth disk, Europe, Africa, Atlantic Ocean. So there is plenty of interesting new data to analyze. And this kind of satellite lighting location data, satellite-based lighting location data has been available also previously during already some 20 years, but they have been measured from low Earth orbit satellites, and that means that that kind of satellite doesn't observe the same location at ground constantly. They just fly over, and so those time series, they are really good, but I would say they are not comparable to geostationary datasets. So here's a just a summary. So about the lighting location detection and how to provide data to end users. It's really light, easy to analyze and so on. But of course, especially nowadays, if you want to detect really efficiently something, you will have to have a really sophisticated hardware. And well, in the coming years, that is one interesting topic. But then I can show you, I think that was the last slide in the presentation, but I can show you an example from our institute's climate service center's archive. If some people, any authority or whatever calls to us and asks, okay, we are analyzing this this and this day, and we are questioning if there has been a lighting present. Do you have any idea? Then we can just take from the archive a certain date, plot the observed flashes during that day, and visualize it on a map really easily, and maybe provide this to the end user who's reading the information. Really easy and fast to calculate. And so also I can show you one actual lighting data file from one day. So this is from last year, June 29th. Let's see what, okay, it doesn't. Okay, this doesn't give any. I will give you one.
Open wind.
Ah, okay, yes, that's right. I'm not a Windows user.
Open wind.
Here.
There. Yeah. And Word back maybe.
Okay. Thank you, Ben. So here you can see one day of located flashes over Finland. Format is you have the date, UTC time, latitude, longitude, peak current, and also estimation about the accuracy of the strike point. The accuracy of these latitude, longitude information. So the system can give an estimation how accurate is this location. And here this is in kilometers, so, and it seems to vary from some couple of hundred of meters to some kilometers. It is actually strongly related to the fact how many sensors have detected the events. And on this day, I think, I'm not sure if this software shows the actual row number, but anyway, there was about 35,000. So in this one data file from one day over Finnish territory, there are 35,000 data rows here. Takes some megabytes of space. Yeah, hard drive. Okay, so that was my short introduction to lighting, location, and thunderstorm research. And if you have any questions, please just ask.
data access, is it possible to get those raw data, or is it only the plots?
Yes, over the Finnish territory, for example, it is now open for anybody. You can. We have a. I'm not sure if it's discussed during this.
It is not.
It is not. So, like, there is now at some institutes, meteorological institutes in Europe, there is a demand to open the data archives, similar style as in the United States.
Yeah.
And at our institute, it is now. It has been done. So, at our open data archive pages, you can also one data feed is the filing location data and the archive, and that is over the Finnish territory. So you can.
So it's country dependent.
Yes, it's country dependent, and also like it is important to mention that actually, like compared to, for example, weather radar networks in Europe or in world, they are usually maintained and owned by meteorological institutes or hydrological institutes. But lightning location business is a bit different. So in, like in Europe, I think more than half of the national networks are not owned by the meteorological institute or service, but a commercial provider, like some electricity company and so on. So this is really like nationality dependent. But in this respect, satellite observations will be excellent benefit. So that will be open to many different groups. Yes.
So you get information on the place and time and peak current.
Yes.
So is it possible, are there a relation between these three and then meteorological probabilities? Of course, these thunderstorms and place and time, but how about this peak current? I was thinking about, are there any possibilities to somehow to assimilate this information to
I didn't mention, well, the peak current may not be or actually I'm not aware of how it is maybe used in some other. It is usually, it correlates well with the damages happening at ground. But then one aspect is the polarity of the flash. So this is a topic I didn't mention, but there are different types of flashes. There are negative and positive. The same electric current flows in the channel, but we determine whether it's negative or positive based on from which charge region inside the cloud the flash originates. And inside the cloud there is a negative and positive charge region.
And you can get it?
Yes, and that information is also marked in the peak current, so it's minus or then no sign at all. And that correlates, like, especially in the United States, they use, I think even in operational forecasting, they use this information, so they monitor the polarity, distribution of the occurring flashes. And when they see, okay, now, if the positive flashes are occurring more frequently, their rate is rising, that correlates, at least in some cases, with, for example, occurrence of tornado or large hail. So that information can be used. Yeah. Yes?
Yeah, I think the at least in the United States and probably in other countries, they incorporate the lightning data into the weather models, at least to some extent, so that they can then do these mesoscale modeling. But it's maybe something that David Tan could touch upon in the afternoon if this is again planned for the reanalysis, because I would imagine that it would, at least in some areas, improve the deep convection precipitation if it was incorporated, and especially with the if the satellite data is becoming available, then that would cover the whole globe, and then it would be much easier to incorporate it rather than just from specific countries.
Yes.
So.
Yeah, and regarding EUMETSAT, because they are anyway making a lot of different products, and then assimilating the lightning information into different kinds of like convective products and so on. So it'd be really interesting. And also one topic regarding the chemistry of the atmosphere is that lightning flashes, they produce like NO emissions. This one large contributor to the whole atmositheric NO composition. So that kind of problems, I think, are planned from the UN's like geostationary data set also, so get an estimation about it. Emissions.
I think one question I think David had.
Well, again, it's related, but it's along the lines of who do you really see as your end users for these sorts of products? Do you see it as, especially in the context of the climate service? I mean, who's really
what products? Do you mean like these which I saw, or which we discussed here, or?
The sorts of things that you're showing us here.
So ah, yes.
Who would pick these up, and how would it change their behaviour? How would it change what they do if they had this data or didn't have it?
Well, one issue is that if people are working in the like a meteorological institute and making maybe analysis of or making answers to different whether there has been some kind of event. So I think lighting location data is excellent and simple tool to visualize like if there has been present convective weather or not, compared to like scavenging satellite archives or weather radar archives or so on. And also lighting location data can be used, it has been successfully used to fulfill some gaps which you might have in like in weather radar networks. Also to complement the satellite, some satellite products, if they both, like if some satellite product is tuned to show, like for example, convective, the presence of intense convection. If you combine that with lighting location data, you can immediately see whether there has been really some convective. So there are many, many different ways.